You know, in recent weeks, there's been a lot of discussion about this year's Penn football team as it moves closer to its fifth straight Ivy championship and perhaps its first undefeated season since 1904. A key to this success the last 2 years has been the presence of two outstanding athletes who share the tailback duties, senior Rich Comizio and junior Chris Flynn. I talked with both of them yesterday.
University of Pennsylvania's football team has the luxury of two outstanding running backs this year. They've had them for the past 2 years. Senior Rich Comizio has set already many records at Pennsylvania, but the truth of the matter is everybody talks about his athletic accomplishments, but just last week he was nominated for the Academic All-America with a 3.2 academic average.
That is correct, and I feel honored to be a candidate for an award coming from a prestigious school as the Wharton School of Business. And I just hope I get it.
I hope you get it, too. You're majoring in finance?
That is correct. I'm a finance major, and I intend to get into the field of investment banking after school.
Well, you got a good start on it, Rich. Rich, you came to college with something to prove as far as football goes, wasn't it?
Well, when I was getting recruited out of high school, I'm sure Chris could vouch for this himself, more of the 1A schools told myself that I was too small for their program and that I should stick to a lower level of football. And you know, they gave me a great opportunity to come to school here and at University of Pennsylvania, and I feel, you know, that I have been competitive throughout my career.
You sure have. So have you, Chris Flynn. Chris, I know one of the decisions you made to come to Penn was the fact that you could play two sports, lacrosse and football.
Right, yeah, it was a definite factor in my decision, being that also I'm from Philadelphia, I'm close into school, and that my family can come and see me. I like playing both sports. I don't really prefer one to the other. It just is a nice transition from each sport, and it keeps me in shape.
How do you handle the situation that exists between you, the fact that you know that somewhere along in the game you're going to be substituted for? Rich?
Well, I don't mind it at all, and, you know, I've done it since my sophomore year with Steve Ortman and Chris the last 2 years. I think it's good for us personally because, you know, we are... You know, we aren't the big tailback type, you know, the 225-pounder, and you can get a little tired out there if you're on a 12-play drive or something like that. So I think it's, you know, a definite advantage for us.
I think it personally creates a healthy competition. I think we're constantly pushing each other, and when we come off the field, Rich is always the first one to tell me what a play might look like, whether it's inside or outside.
But he doesn't listen.
So we have a good rapport with each other, you know, on and off the field.
We can see that. When you first came to Pennsylvania, did you ever believe that you'd be part of what could happen this year, which is the third straight Ivy League championship in your 3 years that are here, Rich?
Well, when I came in as a freshman, they had only won one championship. That was the start of it. And the freshman team was competitive, and I thought that, you know, we had the right attitude and that it was very possible for us to become the Ivy League champions each year that I was at school.
And in your case, Chris, how do you feel about, is there something different about the Penn football program as you go up against the Ivy League competition?
Well, sure. After the last 3-4 years, we've been the best team year in, year out. And I think that it's just going to continue. Even though we've had a coaching change in the past year, I think that, you know, the level of play has just even gone up. And I don't foresee it in the near future as dropping off.
Tomorrow it's Princeton. Anything special about this game for you?
No, we just think that we have to prove again inside the league that, you know, we are the defending champions, and, you know, we always respect our opponents, and that's something that Coach tells us all the time, and we're looking forward to a good, hard-knock football game.
You're not too far from Philadelphia when you play Princeton.
No, I have my family coming up, and hopefully, we'll both perform, and the team will win.
Well, that's a position, those two, where you talked with yesterday. Very few defenses have seen them inactive and not moving. The Tigers are still in the game. Shows you how tough Penn's defense is. We talked about it in the pregame.
Well,
first in the Ivy and first in the ECAC, so it's...
good score against them, and what Princeton had to do was move their offensive sets around. They did a lot of shifting, which they like to do normally out of the wing tee, but they have shifted a lot and created an unbalanced situation. They have an extra man to one side, an end-over type concept, and they caught him in an end over when they ran the sweep with Wasinki. He got on the corner and he made big yardage. I'm sure we'll see him come back to that.
Coach. Coach Ron Rogerson on the sideline. We had a chance to talk with him earlier about the inconsistency of his team and what his assessment was of the 1986 Princeton Tigers.
Well, we've been a little bit of an up-and-down team. I'd prefer that we play a little bit more of an even keel. But when we are ready to play and motivated, we play pretty well. If we're not at that level, then we probably don't have the Doug Butlers and the Di Tommasos to pull us over the top, and so we're not as good as we should be.
Well, they're playing with some emotion today, and when you play the leaders, that's, you know, can make your season if you can knock them off.
And you know he's told his club, hey, we've got the opportunity. We're going to get the ball right away in this second half. Let's see what we can do with it. And they're ready. This is a very crucial stop right now that they can take the ball and move it with some consistency.
They're already on the field. Penn's still on the sideline waiting to come out. Coach Ed Zubrow very serious, but he's got to be very satisfied so far with the results of this season.
Well, he's got an experienced football team, and you really don't get too upset with anything that happens at this stage. They've been in this situation before. They've won. They've been under pressure. So they're going to play with the guys that have gotten them there, and they just want to know right now they can get the kickoff downfield. They've got to be more aggressive on defense, and they, too, are thinking to get a turnover. Next week, we travel to Hanover, New Hampshire, for the Columbia Lions leading today against Villanova, take on the Big Green of Dartmouth. By the way, Dartmouth's ahead of Yale in the second period. So that'll be a big one in Hanover next week.
I wish we had co-eds like that when you and I were in school. Wish we had co-eds.
That's right.
Brooke Shields, eat your heart out, right? Okay, Jim Grass will put it in play from his own 35-yard line. Deep for Princeton, number one, Wasink, and six, Mark Dexter. Good kick by Grass. Knocks Wasink back. He fumbles it to his own four, picks it up. Out to the 15, he's got a couple blockers, and is tripped up at the 26-yard line by number 47, Chris Lentowitz. Sometimes that happens on the return when a drop reception can result in a big play. Gary Weisglass, who came in for Brad Hammond at quarterback, will begin at the helm for the Tigers in the second half. Pretty good first half for his first action all season long. The wing tee, the backs in two-point stance. Wasink in motion, the give up the middle to DeFelice, and he gets about 3 yards up to the 29-yard line. Check that, Santillo on the carry. Second down and seven.
Weisglass coming into this game really to run the offense. He's only attempted 5 passes. I'm sure we'll see more of the ball up in the air this second half, but they just want to give him confidence and get this running game going.
On a quick drop, he's got his wide receiver, Baker, but a pickup barely back to the line of scrimmage.
Little sideline cut, out pattern by Baker. Baker, the leading receiver coming into this game with 18 receptions and 244 yards. The ball was there, but he really didn't have a chance to catch it and run with it. He just had a chance to make the catch. So it's third down and two. The ball sits on the Princeton 34-yard line within reach of a first down.
He did manage to pick up 5 yards, even on the diving catch. So Weisglass faces a third down and two at his own 34. Pichette in motion. Fake to Pichette on the roll by Weisglass. He's going to keep it, and he's pressured. Jeff Fortin on the stop at the 31-yard line.
And that's the bootleg action where the quarterback fakes to the fullback, fakes to the halfback sweeping, and comes out on the corner. And Gary Weisglass never had a chance that time because Jeff Fortner, the senior, the physical player on that defense, the experienced player with the speed to get him on the corner, was there.
Weisglass has some running ability, but he doesn't have the speed to get to the corner and outrace the Pennsylvania linebackers.
The Pennsylvania linebackers, as we said over and over again, this is the third time we've seen them this year. They have great running ability. They really can get to the ball.
DiGiacomo very close to his season average, and he gets a big kick, knocking Flynn all the way back to his 20-yard line. Good coverage by Princeton, and he's wrestled down at the 18-yard line. Number 33, David Farina, backup fullback, Beautiful kick.
Great coverage here, but also a terrific job by Flynn going back and feeling this ball, not letting it bounce where it could have gotten them in deeper territory. At least he brings the ball back.
49-yard kick by Rob DiGiacomo. Puts Pennsylvania back deep in their own territory at their own 18-yard line. It's one of the few times you'll see Chris Flynn take a loss on anything. Jim Krochikia to give to Camizio, off tackle. Stays on his feet, now to the 28-yard line. Very close to a first down.
And there you see the balance of Rich Camizio as he breaks that play back inside. He just put his right hand down, kept his feet, and got an extra couple of yards. And when you look up on first and 10, he gets a first down. He moves the ball up over the 25-yard line, and the ball's sitting now on the 28-yard line. They're going to measure it. It's very close to a first down. Got it.
Nope.
They said a little bit short. Okay.
So that will bring up a second down and one at their own 28 for the Pennsylvania Quakers.
This could be a waist down situation for a quarterback. By waist down, we mean he could put the ball up if he wanted to, knowing that he's only got less than a yard to go for a first down. But looking at the way Penn has run the ball in crucial situations, more likely to just go and get that first down on the ground.
Scott Scungio at tight end in for the Quakers. Pitch to fake to Camizio to give to Clark. Keeps on his feet and a first down and big yardage up out to the 39-yard line. Chip Nuzzo on the stop for Princeton.
As we noted earlier, the fullback in the Penn offense carries the ball 6 to 8 times a game. They like to run him inside. They like to run counters with him. He's basically a blocker for the tailback. But Clark is a good enough runner to when he gets that opportunity, to move that ball up the field.
Not used very often, more often a lead blocker or a decoy, but when he gets that ball, he's got a good average. Scungio in motion, give to Camizio, off tackle, and out to the 45-yard line, a pickup of another 5 yards for Penn.
And Penn's coming right at the Princeton defense. Ned Elton that time made the tackle, assisted by the free safety, Dean Cain. But they're coming right after him, running off tackle, coming right at the point of attack. And watch it here as he hands back to him deep, and he's going to run off tackle behind the block of Clark. The linebacker makes the hit, but when you look up, it's second down and 4.
And Ernst and Wilkins blowing the Princeton left side of defensive line off the ball. Camizio with an outstanding afternoon so far, and we're early into the third period. Second down and 4 at the 44. Flynn. 50, midfield, 45, tripped up by number 71, David Rose from behind, not before big yardage.
And if you want to see a beautifully executed play, watch this counterplay. He starts to his left, he cuts back, he gets a great block by 68 Panzini. Look at that hole! And look at him find it and let get upfield. Excellent job by the offensive line of Pennsylvania.
We talked earlier about
a few of your friends right there from Yale, I think.
The quick score of Princeton. Princeton's got to be getting tired on defense by Pennsylvania ball control.
We got one of our infrequent flags today, and it looks to me like it was thrown in the vicinity of the offensive line.
So this will knock Penn back, but what about the Princeton defense staying on the field as long as they are? Really, over the course of the first three quarters.
Exactly. It hurt them particularly in the first quarter. The second quarter, they got a little more balance with their offense, but they can't afford to stand up. Penn's much too physical for them and much too quick for them, and they just have to play for situations here. But they're sitting back trying to read the defense, run to the football once they locate where it is. That's tough to do against Penn. I think you've got to take more chances. But this is a big penalty. It'll push the Penn offense back and create a first and long for Jim Krochikia.
Offense, first down.
That's the referee, David Harrison.
And it's the type of down and distance situation that Krochikia has not been in. With the ball control, the yardage is always going forward, so he's always been in those good passing situations, although he hasn't had to throw it much this afternoon. So you see the proficiency of the offensive line, giving Flynn, Camizio, all the backs a chance to run for a lot of yardage. The delay to Flynn, a penalty marker down, and he's knocked back. David Rose again.
That was a busted play.
There's got to be a mistake there. Krichicki either turned the wrong way or Flynn went the wrong way. But there was a mix-up in the backfield as well as a penalty. And it's going to go against Penn. Watch as Krichicki turns to his right and he crosses in front.
Yeah, he thought the handoff was going to be behind him. It just shows the...
Second down.
Shows the ability to Flynn that they didn't bump into one another. But he comes up with a loss, so Princeton will decline the penalty, bringing up a second down and 18.
Second down and 18, the defense starts to dictate now. Princeton likes to play zone coverage. Let's move back at second down and 23, correction.
Quick handoff to Clark, and he gets nowhere. David Rose, Pete Milano, and a host of other Tigers waiting for him. Penn that time running out of a double wing setup.
It's very important here for Jim Krichicki, as experienced as he is, not to come up with the wrong call, not to put the ball up for grabs, not to get a turnover. If he's going to throw the ball, it's got to be there. And he's got to make sure, because if not, they can afford to punt and put Princeton deep in their own territory.
That's right. They're ahead in this game. They got to make Princeton earn their points. Third and 23 at his own 44. Jim Krichicki, Andrews in motion, the pitch, and the reverse to Andrews. Got a lead blocker. And he's run out. Pete Milano, along with Matt Whalen. We're waiting for the reverse.
Very well diagnosed by the Princeton defense. They were waiting for it, and they did a super job. Here it is. Toss back to Camizio, who hands back to him, and he's going to run behind the block of the quarterback out here. Krichicki, there's just too many defenders. They hung around, they didn't go with the flow, they made a big play, and they're forcing a punt.
So once again for Penn, David Fosnock will kick it away from his own 46. Plenty of time, gets a high kick. Mark Dexter at his own 20, and immediately wrestled to the ground at the 22. Outstanding coverage by the Penn punt team. Chris Evans on the stop for the Quakers. So Princeton will put it in play at their own 22-yard line, trailing 16-7, 8:48 left to go in the third quarter. Columbia laying it to Villanova. Got a senior class that has not seen a victory. They're going for their first one today. 30 games without a win and 26 or 27 in a row. But Columbia's looking to break that long losing streak. Weisslatz on the dump, but thrown behind. Number 33, David Farina, and a penalty marker down.
David Farina trying to get out of the backfield, did not release. He couldn't get out clean. And Weisglass did not have enough time to get him the football. He eventually took the hit himself as he threw the ball, but a flag came down after the play, and here it is. And it's a personal foul, number 45, coming up here for Pennsylvania. We just had to go a little farther. But the call went against number 45 for Pennsylvania, Bruce McConnell, a linebacker.
It's a personal foul on White. It's a dead ball. It's going to be a first down.
Okay, that's the break. You don't want to give too many of those opportunities to a team that's trying to get back at you. Princeton now has a first down. The ball sitting on their own 37.
Double wing. Watsink in motion. To give to Watsink. Going for the corner. He's got a block. And out to the 40-yard line. Donald Johnson up from his cornerback position. And another penalty marker down. The finger seems to be pointed at Pennsylvania, Jeff Fortner. A late hit on number 81, Mike Behrman, the tight end.
This will get you upfield in a hurry.
Very uncharacteristic of Pennsylvania, and it's the indication is a face mask.
And Ed Zubrow saying to the official, that's wrong. Well, anyway, they tack on another 15 here. And they're going to get the ball up over the mid-stripe. Here we go.
So Princeton, the beneficiary of two successive penalties, will now put it in play at the Pennsylvania 45-yard line.
Dead ball foul. Personal foul. Face mask on the white. It's a first down.
15-yard face mask tackle. That's a tough one to see. There it is.
What? Well, it wasn't on the tackle. It was on a receiver a few further yards downfield. So Princeton, Wasink, off tackle, dipped, and knocked down there by Hippensteel.
Again, they're trying to get Wasink, the man in the backfield that has the speed, on the corner, off the sweep, off the wing tee sweep. They fake to the fullback, give to the halfback coming across. Hippensteel, number 99, very quick, got up to make the hit, kept it to a 3-yard gain.
Even with Wasink's elusiveness, it's a little tougher running to the short side of the field. So Princeton with a pickup of 3 yards, look at a second down and 7 at the Pennsylvania 42-yard line. Gary Weisglass, a senior quarterback, looking to throw deep. Intercepted at the 30-yard line. And run back. Hippensteel waiting for that throwback.
And that's the inexperience. The quarterback that time, as he dropped back, again, he looked to his left and threw back to his right, looking to get upfield on the split receiver. Hippensteel, the outside linebacker. See him turn left. Now he comes back to the right. He puts the ball up, but look at Hippensteel and the depth he's gotten. And he's in the right place. And Weisglass, they can chalk that one against him, the inexperience by putting the ball right there. But a big play by the Penn defense. Again, we look at it as he looks left, turns back to his right. He was looking for...
Give the Camisio a cutback, stays on his feet. Very close to the 40-yard line.
He was looking for his back out of the backfield that time. Greg DeFelice, one of his fullbacks. He was open, but Hippensteel made a big play, and now Penn is on the march offensively.
That's good discipline by Hippensteel, because even though Weisglass turned to his left, he didn't roll left, so the defensive coverage didn't roll with him. They held their ground, and he was waiting for that throwback. Pickup of 7 yards. Krochickia looks at a second down and 3 at the Princeton 41-yard line. Delay and give to Flynn. And he looks back, but he's wrestled down. It was 2-yard loss. Number 25, Chip Nuzzo. And Miami still trailing Florida State. Miami number 1 in the country. A quarterback like Testaverde, though, they're never out of the game, particularly only trailing by 2 points. 6:32 left to go in the third quarter. Penn leading 16-7. Krochicki on the play action. Gets some pressure. Got the time. He's got Novoselsky at the 40. And run out of bounds.
That big receiver, that strong receiver, Brent Novoselsky, the junior from Skokie, Illinois. He found him as he broke to the outside. He was covered tightly, but Krochickia put the ball right in there, and you'll see Novoselsky as he comes out of this little play fake to the fullback, makes the catch with the defender really all over him. Makes the catch and just tries to get upfield for the first down, falls a little short, and it's fourth down and about 2.5 to go, and Ed Zubrow decides to come in with his punting team. With the ball sitting on the 41-yard line of Princeton, that's a good choice.
Well, Princeton benefited from about a yard on the placement, so Penn will kick it away. Looking to hang it up, and he does, very high. A fair catch at the 9-yard line by number 25, Chip Nuzzo, and a penalty marker goes down. Take a look at see what the call was. So it's fair catch interference on Pennsylvania, which will help Princeton get out of their hole.
And what he's saying there is that the defender coming down did not give him enough room to make the fair catch.
The opportunity to catch, non-contact, 5 yards. First down.
And here it is from a good angle. We see it. That's a good shot by our cameraman. As he comes by, he really didn't have a chance. And that was Lentzowitz, a defensive back covering on that. He came by and flashed in front of him, so he didn't have access to the ball, clearly.
Princeton still pinned back. They only picked up 5 yards on the penalty. Wasink cuts back and out to the 20-yard line. A nifty move by Wasink. from his tailback position.
That's one of the difficulties of the wing tee, a difficulty of a back trying to run laterally to get on the corner. It's so different from an eye back who's deeper and has a better angle. You've really got to have speed to get on the corner. He was successful earlier. Now they're shutting off the outside while Sink took advantage and cut back inside to the flow that was a little bit too wide, and he got good yardage.
Second down and three at the 20. Wing tee with one wide receiver. Fake by wide flag. He's going to keep it. And runs out of bounds and smacks down at the 23-yard line. Rick Inskeep said hello.
Said hello, but Wiseglass had enough presence to know where the sticks were, and he got the first down, and he's got the speed and the size to get on the corner that time. It was a big play, but he can't afford to take hits like that too often. I'm sure that Ron Rogerson is very pleased with the effort thus far. He's got to get his offense just upfield and get another score here, but he's got to be pleased with the way the Tigers are hanging in there against this strong Penn football team.
Wiseglass on the short roll left. He's going to keep it. Break the tackle. Out to the 30. Big, strong quarterback out to the 34-yard line and very close to another first down.
And what happens? Brian, you can relate to that. You're in trouble. What do you do best? You run, so he naturally takes off.
Well, it presents a lot of problems for the defense because they don't know. They've never seen him play. A big, strong quarterback is not going to be brought down with a hand tackle, as it's shown there. And he picks them yardage. They don't know what he can do as a passer, but he's shown he can tuck the ball away and go.
Now they bring into the game Wasink at halfback, Princeton does, and Mark Dexter, the split receiver, who's got a lot of good speed. They may want to try and get either one of them deep.
Also, with a threat to the quarterback to run, it really opens up the short passes to the backs. The give to Wasink on the draw. And he gets about two, a late fumble, but whistled dead. So far this season, for the Tigers, the leading rusher has been Jerry Santillo, but he has not carried the ball very often this afternoon. Derek Wasink being the workhorse.
And they're mixing their plays up a lot. They're trying to do a variety of things because they don't have that one back, that Camizio type or Chris Flynn type that can take you off the hook. A lot of other people have to do it. So they've just got to come up with the right combination. Yeah, they really haven't had it all year. They just don't have that kind of quality running back that can break open a game for them. So now it's the quarterback, in this case, Wiseglass, is trying to do it.
Wiseglass with a quick throw and incomplete at the 49-yard line to number 81, Mike Behrman.
Mike Behrman's the tight end. He's a big guy, 6'4", 235. He's got six receptions this year for 143 yards. They like him, but really the tight end has not been a factor for either team today in their passing offense. And in the wing tee offense, the tight end should be a prominent receiver, especially on the counter stuff, where he drags across and gets behind the linebackers.
Wiseglass now faces a third down and six at his own 37-yard line. Pennsylvania showing blitz and coming, throwing underneath the Baker and complete out to the 45-yard line.
Single coverage on Baker, 83, and Wiseglass found him. They came with a blitz. As you see, Baker's the wide receiver here. He comes underneath, zone covers, the defender falls down, but he wouldn't have covered him either way. He just had a good cushion, and Wiseglass knew who he was looking for. Good execution of the first down.
Princeton is showing a lot of different formations, even out of the wing tee, and they give to Wasink, and he's got a block, and he's out past midfield and into Pennsylvania territory. Inskeep, along with Hippensteel, run Wasink out of bounds.
And probably for the first time today, this is the most consistent drive for the Princeton's offense. They're mixing their plays, as we noted, and they're getting yardage, and they're coming up with good selections now. Now it's 6 yards on a first down run, second and four. They're well ahead of schedule.
Princeton has given up a lot of points in certain games, but have shown this afternoon that they're continuing the defensive effort from last week against Harvard, holding them to just a field goal. Second and four. Wiseglass on the option. Pitch. The check. Midfield and fairly back to the line of scrimmage. May have picked up about 1 or 2 yards.
First time he's been able to get the pitch off in the option. By the time he did get it to Fichette, he picked up a yard, maybe 2 yards, creating a third and short here. By the time he did get him the ball, the secondary reacted. There is Brad Hammond, the senior quarterback, who has a broken bone in his right shoulder.
And the tough thing is, it's his right shoulder, so he really has very little chance of coming back and into the remaining games for the Tigers. An interesting injury, too, because usually it's the collarbone or a separated shoulder, not a broken bone in the shoulder. Third down and 2. The give up the middle and a first down. Jerry Centillo down to the 39-yard line of Pennsylvania. Another first down for Princeton.
Here comes 32, the fullback. They'd like to run him inside behind the block on the right side. He gets a good block from Fichette, who comes in from the halfback position to block on the linebacker. Santillo gets up inside and makes good yardage, and another first down for Princeton. 140 remains in the third period.
Minute and a half left to go in the third quarter, and it's time to give again to Wapsink. He's got a lead blocker. He cuts back inside the 25 and down to the 22-yard line. Run out of bounds by Mike Henley.
And the Penn defense is starting to show some wear. Perhaps they've been on the field too long. Look at the way they get on the corner as Wasink comes across the formation following number 32. There's a lot of blocks and a lot of white shirts on the ground for the first time today. And that's big running before 57 comes up to make the play. Henley, the inside linebacker. Fortner was out, the leader on the defense at the outside linebacker position. He's back in to support the run, I assume.
A big day for Derek Wasink. Time, Centillo, the fullback, down to the 18-yard line, a pickup of about 4.
You got to say some things about that Princeton offensive line. They're starting to make some holes, and giving the fullback a chance to run also inside. And we're looking at Jerry Courier, the center, the senior, and also Josh Chambliss, a junior, who was in the starting position at right guard. That time they made 2 excellent blocks to give the fullback a chance to run, pick up 4 yards.
And they say the longer the offense is on the field, the more effective the offensive line becomes. And they are blowing Pennsylvania off the ball. Second down and 6 at the 18. Fichette in motion. The give to Wasink. Underneath and down to the 16. Very short gain. Met there by most of the Penn interior linemen. That should be the final play of the third quarter. Princeton on the move.
Princeton on the move behind a senior quarterback that's seen very little action in his career, Gary Weisglass. Gary Weisglass is the story offensively thus far for Princeton.
At the end of the third quarter, Penn ahead 16-7. The Ivy League Game of the Week made possible by grants from and Wolf. The Ivy League Football Game of the Week is made possible by grants from the financial professionals at Payne Weber and by Chrysler, makers of Plymouth Voyager, where the pride is back. Beginning of the fourth quarter, Princeton on the move, trailing 16-7, but knocking on the Quakers' door. Third down and 4 at the 16-yard line. Princeton controlling the line of scrimmage in this last drive.
Penn comes in with some substitutions in the secondary. They bring in Tom Flynn as one of the cornerbacks. They bring in an extra defensive back anticipating the pass here on third down and 4. It's pretty tough to do against the wing T because they have so much variety, and they could very well run the football in this situation if they're in the 4-down zone. They come out with a double wing, but they'll shift their motion into a strength of the formation.
The fourth quarter begins. Weisglass on the roll. He's going to keep it. And he's got the first down down at the 10-yard line. Looked like run all the way.
It sure was. And he ran it away from the field and into the sideline, away from the strength. And that created an imbalance. And he's got enough size and speed to get that, and he got the first down. Here we go. He's running back into the sideline. He's got the blockers in front of him, along with Harrer, his offensive guard, who makes the hit on the corner. Another first down.
Mike Lista on the stop from behind, from his defensive tackle position.
Now we can see that Penn has to play tight. They may have to come to man coverage. In that situation, you got to look for the back out of the backfield or the tight end.
First and 10, just outside the 10 to fake the Wasink underneath. Weislatt fires and thrown behind his receiver in the end zone, number 81, Behrman.
And that was the tight end coming across off the play fake, off the bootleg action, deep in the end zone. He slipped, and also Weislatt had a defender coming right up in his face, and he threw the ball behind him.
He gunned it, but too far behind tight end Mike Behrman.
85, Rockefeller comes in. Rockefeller's the sophomore tight end with lots of speed, and he can get open in that end zone. Rogerson is very high on him as a receiver, runs very well.
So Baker's split wide to the left. Weislatt stays in the pocket. The dump to Fichette. He's got a blocker. He stays on his feet, but he's wrestled down from behind by number 59, Sebastianelli, but he picks up about 4 yards.
Well-executed play. Again, sprinting to the field, to the wide side, to the strength, and throwing it back, the screen back, into the sideline to the halfback, Fichette.
The things they're doing on offense, taking advantage of a very aggressive pursuing Penn defense.
Exactly. But the quarterback is different because he can run and he's a threat, and that adds a whole dimension to their offense, puts a lot more pressure on a defense.
Third down and 6 at the 7-yard line. Gary Weislatt on the roll. Throws. Behrman incomplete in the end zone. Brad Hines on the coverage.
Excellent coverage by the Penn defense, the secondary. Flynn had the wide receiver, Wasink covered, and Hines, as you described it, had the tight end well covered.
Here it is on the replay. The problem on the roll, you got to be ready to throw on the break, and he was a little late. Behrman had already made his cut, but good and tight coverage by Brad Hines in the end zone. So Princeton will attempt the field goal from the 14-yard line, 24 yards. Rob Goodwin trying to cut the deficit to 6 points. High snap, he gets it down. Kick is up, and it's good. So Princeton is now within 6 points of the league-leading Pennsylvania Quakers. 13-36 left to go in the game. Princeton now trails 16-10.
And as we've said so many times in this Ivy League, there are certain games that you just know are tough games, no matter what the records can be, will be. And when you look at this game, Princeton, having lost 3 years in a row to Pennsylvania, but has played them very tough each year, and Ed Zubrow knew that coming in today. Besides, the Penn Quakers have been very consistent this year. They've really been up week in and week out, and that's a tough thing to do. I think they're playing tough today. They've made a few bad penalties on a couple of drives for Princeton in the second half that gave them an opportunity to get upfield. They've got to do something here offensively, something they haven't done since midway of the second quarter, and that's get upfield with their offense to get some points.
You see, Miami went ahead, and Pennsylvania, being the top of the league for the last 3 years outright and shared 2 years prior, everybody shoots for them, so every game's a tough one. That drive was 79 yards in 17 plays, resulting in a 24-yard field goal. Time off the clock, 7.5 minutes. So Princeton showing a little Pennsylvania-like ball control. Goodwin will kick it away from his 35. 13-36 left to go in the game. Deep for Penn, a ubiquitous Mr. Flynn. Jim Bruni, number 42, and Bruni's got it. Fumbles it, picks it up at the 16, the 20, the 25, out to the 35, but a penalty marker is down. Number 35, Steve Lechmanic on the stop for Princeton, but take a look at the marker.
That's going to push him back.
So things going Princeton's way, the end of the third quarter, the beginning of the fourth. And they're right in the thick of this game.
Flip. On the run dash. First down.
Pennsylvania making a lot of mistakes that we haven't seen them make. Krochickia, the quarterback, at his own 12. Two tight ends. They give to Comizio, and he's out past the 20-yard line.
And what do you do when you got pressure on you and trouble? You go to your best back, and that time it was a simple toss sweep with Fricchia running up behind the right side of the line. Pennsylvania cannot afford to have a turnover here. They don't want to give the ball up. They got to sustain their drive, but they can't afford to give the ball up in this deep territory. And I know that, and they've got experience in there at quarterback, fullback, and tailback.
Quick give to Clark. He's out to the 25-yard line, and a first down. So Penn relying on their ground game, getting them out of deep in their own territory. Flynn back in the game with Saunders, number 17. Flynn and Comizio alternating almost every play. Saunders and Andrews, the wide receivers. Novotel's get a tight end. Tom Clark, the fullback. Flynn behind him. Novotel's in motion. Flynn, 30, out to the 34-yard line, a pickup of almost 10 yards.
Just an off-tackle slant on the left side behind Ernst and the tight end, Novoselsky. Flynn, the quickness, here we see him. He just takes that ball, he looks for the seam, and watch him generate right there. And he's up in the seam, breaks the tackle, picks up enough that they will, it's just a little bit short of a first down, about 9 yards. Injury on the field for Princeton.
Dean Kane is the man down, and he was the one on the tackle.
Dean Kane, the free safety, the junior from Malibu, California. His coach, Ron Rogerson, said he's the best at his position, free safety, in the league. He's tough against the run, and he's a great defender, fine athlete. They can't afford to miss him. He's a hitter.
Flynn, lowering his shoulder. Tough to tell what the injury is. Sometimes you get hit by your own people. It looks like he got either in the head or shoulder.
It's probably the head because he came up and took him on. But he's getting up and he's been replaced. Twice. Number 44 is in the game. Dave Wilson has come in to replace Dean Campbell. He looks okay.
In the vernacular, that's called getting your bell rung, but he will probably be back.
Some Big Ten scores coming in the fourth period. Ohio State ahead of Iowa. Alabama bouncing back from their loss to Penn State against Mississippi State.
So Pennsylvania looking at second down and less than a yard at their own 34-yard line. This time, double receivers to the wide side. Clark and Comizio behind Krochikia. Play action. Throws the curl to Saunders. Complete at the 49-yard line of Princeton. Krochikia firing that ball into Saunders.
And he waited for him to come open that time. He didn't force the ball. Saunders, the wide receiver outside of Andrews, curled back to the ball. Krochikia making a play fake to his left, came back off that action, waited for him to get open, and made the hit.
That's a team manager for the Princeton Tigers.
Things have changed. Terrific.
First and 10 for Pennsylvania, just over midfield. Flynn on the cutback, 45, bounces off, staying his feet, and another first down inside the 40-yard line.
That was the 14th carry of the afternoon for Chris Flynn, and that pushes him over 75 yards for 14 carries. Comizio has carried the ball 21 times for 117 yards, but the Quakers only have 16 points at this juncture of the game.
11 minutes left to go in the fourth quarter. Pennsylvania hanging on to a six-point lead. Pitch to Comizio. Breaks a tackle in the backfield and run out by Derek Armstrong at the 38-yard line.
Again, trying to go back into the sideline. Good defense by Princeton. They forced him to go out of bounds. Got enough for the first down. Now the Quakers have the ball inside the 40-yard line, first and 10. Chris Flynn back into the game.
It's over the 35-yard line, down to the 30. pick up a 9 yards.
And that's the play. That's a tough play to defend against. Chip Nuzzo comes up from the strong safety position to make the hit. But this is the counter. He starts to the right, gets the ball back, follows the blocking on the left side of number 68, the offensive guard Panzini, the right guard who pulls through. And when you look up, he's got 9 yards.
Second down and two at the Princeton 30-yard line. Pennsylvania on the move. Camizio smacked down at the 28. Very close to a first down.
Villanova coming back in the third period. Columbia still ahead, trying to win that first game in 30. 28-21 in the third quarter.
Pennsylvania going with what's Brungham here. Their ball control offense with tailbacks Chris Flynn and Rich Camizio. Flynn. And one of the few times he stopped and a penalty marker goes down. Right on the pile at the 27-yard line.
Going to go against Pennsylvania. It's thrown in the area of the interior line, and there you get the signal from the referee that it's holding. Good drive by the Quakers. They move from deep in their own territory with no mistakes here. As they get close in Princeton's territory, they come up with a big penalty.
So this will knock Pennsylvania back and stop the momentum, give Princeton a break. They need to hold them here. Down by 6 points with 9:42 left to go in the game.
Free safety. Dean Kane is back into the ball game. He missed a few plays, but he's back in there at the free safety position, and he's a leader.
On the offense, first down, 20 yards.
They need him not only as a defender, but also as a run supporter. From his free safety position, he has the speed to come up and make the hit, as we've seen.
First down and 20. Novoselsky flexed at tight end. Two wide receivers. They give to Camizio off tackle. He gets back to the 35-yard line.
They were just trying to catch him that time, figuring they had a first down and 20 to go, that they'd slip the ball to Camizio and Princeton thinking pass and maybe make some yardage, but the defense held. And now it's second down and 17. The ball's right on the 35-yard line. Camizio goes out. Flynn comes back into the ball game. For Chicky at quarterback, two wide receivers in the game, 24 Rob Andrews and 20 the junior Tom Joyce.
Long count.
A lot of pushing and shoving out there as defenders came across the line of scrimmage. The quarterback backed out of there without the ball. So this will be an interesting call.
Quarterback is allowed to do that, although sometimes they call the illegal procedure when he backs out too quickly as opposed to looking like a shift. So they will call it on Krochikia, knocking Penn back another 5 yards.
Here's Krochikia backing away. He doesn't have the ball, but Nick Elton is going to take a shot at him. Not Krochikia, and he's defending himself at all times.
On the wide.
But a mistake again by the Penn offense. Pushes him back. It's now second and 22. The ball's at the 40-yard line.
Saunders back in for Joyce at wide receiver. Andrews on the other side. Fake. Camizio looking deep for Andrews. And incomplete in the end zone. He had his man open.
That time they ran the tight end in the middle to occupy the free safety and tried to get Andrews, the speedster, from the split end position up the middle behind the free safety, one-on-one with the cornerback Armstrong, and we'll see it right here. Watch 11 come up on the tight end. You see him go with the tight end. There goes Andrews. He's got him beat. But Krochikia just didn't put the ball up enough to drop it in. He outthrew him.
Man for man defense by the Tigers. Kevin Armstrong's got to learn when there's no free safety. He's got to take the inside position. Post pattern is a lot easier to throw than the corner or the fly. So Krochikia now looks at a third down and 22 at Princeton's 40-yard line. Throws and incomplete to Novoselsky. Broken up by Matt Heisler looking for his second interception.
And the Princeton defense, taking advantage of a few penalties against Penn, has held again, and they're going to force another punt. That time, Jim Krochikia forced the ball a little bit. Was well covered by the linebacker Heisler, and Lisowski was not open.
Bosnott will kick it away. High kick going for the corner. Kane at his 12 and runs out of bounds. Good play by Kane. So Princeton trailing 16-10, 8:24 left to go in the game. Plenty of time. They need a big drive, and they got this partisan crowd behind them. Coach Ron Rogerson wanted to get them in the game.
Back into the game at quarterback, the senior Gary Weisblatt. Second half, he's come on. He's done some nice things running the football and passing the football.
Working from his own 12, to Chet in motion. Weisblatt on the quick pressure. Gets away, he's going to keep it. Gets the corner and runs out of bounds at the 17-yard line. Showing good presence, got pressured, back in the backfield.
And showing good speed. It looked like he was running about three-quarter speed, yet he got on the corner and made the first down. Excuse me, got out of bounds after picking up 6 yards. Stopped the clock, second down and four.
To block out to the 23 and very close to a first down. Brad Hippensteel on the tackle for the Quakers.
Coming into this ball game, we knew that there was a possibility we would see Gary Weisglass. Ron Rogerson talked about bringing him in for running situations if he couldn't get his offense going normally. We didn't expect to see him so soon. He came early because Brad Hammond, the senior quarterback and starter, was injured in the first period. He comes into the game, and there he is, Weisglass. He's gone the rest of the way. And it's in his hands right now. Down 6 points with 7:50 remaining in the fourth period. The ball sits on the Princeton 23-yard line.
Weisblatt, the throw. He's got Machette in the flat. And immediately wrestled down by number 11, Tom Flynn. Weisblatt showing good strength on those long flat patterns. Hasn't thrown the ball deep too much except his one completion to Rockefeller earlier in the first half.
And I'm sure the Princeton bench is going to try and keep the plays fairly simple, not put him in tough situations, make him successful, and also stay away from the troubles. They don't want to have an interception. They want to keep possession here and get upfield with a chance to score and win this football game.
Weisblatt on the option, pitches late, fumble, and Pennsylvania recovers.
And that's the mistake. And that was on the quarterback, and you'll see it when Weisblatt comes out of his fake on the option. He pitches the ball. There's Weisblatt. As he pitches the ball, it's a low pitch to Fichette, who's coming in motion 41. He makes his fake to the fullback. Now watch, he's going to his left. And he just puts the ball low and behind him, and he never really has a chance. And the fumble recovery was made by number 46, Brad Hines, the senior captain on the defense, the Roverback.
Pennsylvania with excellent field position, trying to put the game away. Camizio off tackle, down to the 17-yard line. One of the problems with running the option with a right-handed quarterback is pitching with your left hand, particularly if you haven't seen much action.
And I'm sure the option has been something they've been working on this week. They really hadn't shown the option up to this point. They felt maybe they could execute something different in the offensive scheme against Penn with the option. And you're right. It's probably inexperience and also the fact that it was new to them this week that created that problem for him.
Plus, as a second quarterback, he's probably not going to get a lot of repetitions during the week. Krochikia, second down and five at the Princeton 17. Flynn thrown back at the 20-yard line. Number 90, Ned Elton, from his defensive end position. said earlier, Flynn is not thrown for many losses. Elton coming in, knocking him back 3 yards on that play.
The co-captain, Ned Elton. The Princeton defense has hung tough, particularly in the second half, to keep this game within reach. They've benefited from penalties, but they've hung pretty tough in crucial situations, and they have to hang tough now. It's 3rd and 7 with the ball sitting on their 20-yard line, and Jim Krochickia wants to make sure he's got the right call. He's called timeout, and he's going over to the sideline to talk to his coach.
Dean Kane and number 57, Matt Heisler, do the same.
It's very important. Very important here. Brian, as we know, the ball sitting on the 20-yard line, if they can't come up with a first down, they can't come up with a score, they want to be in position to try for three. If they get three, they make it difficult for Princeton because that'll push them ahead by 9. So it's a kind of a crucial call here. If not with a first down, at least keep good field position and give Jim Grass, their kicker, a chance to put it through for 3 points.
Plus, with Flynn's ability on the draw play, it's really a safe play. It's almost guaranteed to pick up 3 or 4 yards to make the field goal easily within Grass's range. Miami beginning to stretch out their lead over Florida State.
And there's a very surprising score.
Wow. Dartmouth 39 over Yale 7. Dartmouth enjoying, or very soon to enjoy, their first win of the season.
And we'll see him next week. We'll see him in Hanover. Next week in Hanover, it's Columbia at Dartmouth.
Krochickia with 2 tight ends. 3rd down and 7. Comizio, the tailback. Clara, the fullback. Long count. And the give to Comizio. He's got a blocker. He's got a first down. Inside the 10 and inside the 5. Down to the 2. Rich Comizio.
And what they did that time, as you called it, they came with 2 tight ends. That makes the defense, it creates a problem for them because you don't have a strength there. And they caught him on the backside, and you'll see it from the low angle here as Comizio cuts back. He gets great blocking from Scungio, 81, 75. How would you like to be running behind a tackle of 6'3", 235, Chris Wilkins? And there's the difference. They've got the ball inside the 5-yard line.
First and goal at the 2. Krochickia looks to back out a little early. And Zubrow's got to be happy with that last play. Comizio going all the way down to the 2-yard line.
Take a look at this play again. Watch everybody start to the left. The fullback, number four. Oh, this play here is the fumble. Excuse me. What happened was the quarterback had the play. Okay, that was a legal procedure. Krochickia called the play. And the ball was snapped to him. He wasn't expecting it. He's called for a legal procedure. The ball is pushed back to the 7-yard line. We're at 1st and goal on the 7.
Problem for the Tigers, trailing by 6. Give Comizio off tackle and tripped up, actually over his own man, but well defended there by Matt Whalen.
And that's the play that they've run so effectively with Comizio and Flynn, the cutback, the counter play. And that time he saw an opening inside, but he decided maybe he could break it to the outside and get the touchdown. Unfortunately, his guard, pulling from the right side, Panzini, was in the way and he tripped over him.
And you see time winding down. Even if Penn doesn't do anything here, it still puts the Tigers in a hole with very little time left. 2nd down and 8 from the 8. Krochickia. Pressure. Intercepted. Dean Kane. He's got an open field. He's got some blockers. Breaks the tackle and out to the 44-yard line. Interception by Dean Kane puts Princeton in the driver's position to get back in it to take the lead.
Here it is. Krochickia has got time. He's got a little pressure, but he's got time to throw the ball, and he just puts it up. He's looking right there for Novoselsky, 85, but the free safety comes over, makes the catch, and He's called by his coach the best at that position. That's a big play. There's 4 minutes and 9 seconds left in the fourth period. Princeton has the ball on its own 43-yard line.
Good field position for Wiseglad. Give Pichette. Tripped up. Number 59, Sebastian Ellie.
There he is, number 11, Dean Kane, a junior. That's the third interception this year. Fine athlete.
A loss of about one brings up a second down and 11 for Princeton, but in good field position at their own 43-yard line. Plenty of time left, 3.5 minutes. Trailing 16-10. Up the middle and out very close to the 50-yard line. Fumble. We'll see if they marked it before the whistle. And they did.
And now, pressure's on for the first time this year. Pennsylvania's got to really regroup and stay tough on defense. That time the fullback broke it up inside. Number 33, Farina. We see him right here. Excuse me, number 32, Santillo. And he fumbles the football. The official rules that he fumble the ball as he hit the ground, and we know that can't the ground cannot create a fumble, so he rolled, but the ball was dead there. Picked up 5 yards, 6 yards actually. It's a third and five situation.
I think Princeton benefited from the linesman being blocked by one of the 10 defenders, but Princeton retains possession right at midfield, third down and five. This is definitely four down territory for the Tigers.
That's Santillo, the fullback, number 32, holding his left hand or wrist as he comes off the field.
So the clock starts, 3 minutes left to go in the game. Gary Wiseglass leading the Tigers, going for that go-ahead touchdown. Third down and five at midfield. The give, Pichette, and stopped at the 45. A loss back to the 44-yard line.
Once again, they took it. They took the chance of pressuring, getting in the gaps, and number 99, Hippensteel, got right up on the line of scrimmage, got in the backfield, and got to Pichette before he could ever turn it upfield, and got him for a big loss. And now with the ball inside, pushed back to their 44-yard line, Princeton faces a fourth and nine, and they got to go for it.
Mark Dexter, number six, comes in for Craig Pichette. So they're going to go with an extra wide receiver, Baker and Dexter. Split out wide to the wide side. And Wiseglass in the shotgun. Unbalanced line. Wiseglass on the drop. Got pressure and he's sacked. And a fumble. But Penn will take over. 99, Brad Hippensteel on the blitz.
Brad Hippensteel, they took the chance. Fourth down and nine. Four, three receivers to one side. They brought Hippensteel from the backside, and he got to him. He made a big hit. He showed his speed. The junior from Tampa, Florida, number 99, made the play. Well, we have a few people being shuffled off the field. Pennsylvania takes over with the ball sitting on the Princeton 40-yard line.
Penn has shown a tendency to blitz when in the shotgun or the position where there's no blocking backs, and the quarterback's got to get rid of the ball quick for any chance. There he does. We saw it last week against Yale. They blitzed Ryan from the shotgun, pressuring him into early throws or not being able to throw at all. So Penn will take over. 1:49 left to go in the game, holding on to a 16-10 lead.
And there's problems down there for Chickie, the left guard for Pennsylvania, jumped offside, Chris Wilkins. So there's got to be something in the cadence or something that's bothering him, because that's the third time today we've had that exchange problem with the quarterback in the center and now with the guards, the offensive linemen.
Dead ball foul, illegal procedure on the offense.
Moves it back to the 44-yard line. First down and 15 for Pennsylvania. Give, Camizio. Dives down to the 41-yard line. And timeout down on the field. Pennsylvania. We'll be right back after a word from our sponsors. The Ivy League Football Game of the Week is made possible by grants from the financial professionals at Payne Weber. And by Chrysler, makers of Plymouth Voyager, where the pride is back. All of us on the Ivy League Network would like to add a special thanks to these fine underwriters who are making these Ivy telecasts possible. 1:39 left to go in the game. Pennsylvania, anything but world beaters today, but hanging on to that six-point lead and showing that even on an off day, they still have enough to win.
Ed Zubrow calls the entire offense. We've seen him do that with the offense and the defense. The entire offense over to the sideline to talk to him, and what he's telling them is simply, hey, we can't lose our poise here. No mistakes. Let's hold on to the football and eat this clock up. And there we see Brown coming back against Harvard, moving ahead 24-16. That ball game is being played in Cambridge.
After pickup of 6, second down and 9, Quinn cuts back. First down. He's got room. He's got a touchdown. Chris Quinn.
Crowd, Ed Zubrow breathes a sigh of relief, but Chris Flynn just ran 41 yards for a touchdown. And I tell you, you got to be impressed with his ability to cut back against the grain. That's a shot of the sideline, number one, the offensive running back, Derek Wasink, who's had a fine day for Princeton. He's a senior. He was thinking of the possibilities, his last shot at Pennsylvania. They played tough today, very tough. A couple of mistakes. And the Penn defense, rising to the occasion at the end, created the fumble and the turnover. And we just saw Chris Flynn break one for 41 yards. And that was his 17th carry today. And our unofficial totals give him 119 yards and 17 carries. That's pretty impressive. And then you look at Rich Camizio. He had 28 carries so far today for 151 yards.
Each of us playing only half the time. Grass with the extra point. It's good. So Pennsylvania, with an additional touchdown late in the game, goes ahead of Princeton 23-10.
And here we see it. This play has been a big play all day. It's the counter. He hands back to him on the right side. He follows number 77, Ernst, through the hole. Gets a block downfield from Scott Scungio, number 81. But there's the cutback. And when he does it, everybody's overflowed to the right, and he's gone. Only a junior. Last week against Yale, he passed the 1,000 rushing mark.
And second a week in a row, over 100 yards. Both Camizio and Flynn, over 100 yards today. So outstanding accomplishment for both tailbacks, but as you saw in that replay, great blocking by that front five of Pennsylvania. Princeton putting a valiant effort today with a chance to win late in the game. That's what Coach Ron Rogerson wanted his team to be able to do. Pennsylvania just a little bit too strong. Got to be happy with the effort of the Tigers this afternoon.
Well, he's happy because they stayed close, but knowing the kind of competitor that Ron Rogerson is, he's not at all happy because he knew he had a shot today, especially in the fourth quarter, and I'm sure he's disappointed for that. Be the fourth straight victory by Pennsylvania over Princeton as they move towards another Ivy League title, their fifth, and also for the first time in a long time, back to 1904, the possibility of an undefeated season.
Grass to Dexter at his own 7, to the 20, and knocked down at the 26-yard line. Parker Rode, a defensive end, makes the stop for the Quakers. So Weisglass will come back on the field. Well, Columbia was close, but they're now looking at a 14-point deficit late in the third quarter. So that win is elusive. 124, he left at Princeton, New Jersey. Weisglass on the quick out to Fichette, but underthrows him.
That was Weisglass' 14th attempt today. He's had 7 completions for 77 yards, 1 interception. He has rushed the ball 13 times for 31 yards. And Ron Rogerson knows with the injury to Brad Hammond that he's going to have to go the rest of the way against William & Mary next week, Yale the following week, and closing here at Dartmouth in 2 weeks. He's going to have to go with Gary Weisglass at quarterback.
Weisglass throwing underneath to Wasink, who drops it at the 32-yard line. McConnell on the hit. So Weisglass will look at a 3rd and 10 as we look at next week's schedule for the Ivy League.
And that, we thought that first game would be a tough one because Yale knew that they were still in the hunt a little bit, and Cornell was undefeated. But going up there to play, and after we saw the score of Dartmouth-Yale today, that may not be as pivotal a game.
At the 20-yard line, Mike Lista. Very tough to keep these guys out at this point in the game. You see a lot of stars on his helmet. He's had a very proficient season up to this point. So Weisglass comes off. Welcome to playing quarterback.
Playing quarterback against the best in the league at this time. But he's a senior, and he's probably welcomed the opportunity to have a chance, and I'm sure he's going to have a chance the next 3 weeks. There were some things he did today that were very positive, and I'm sure that Ron Rogerson will try to simplify things over the next 3 weeks to give him a chance to succeed and also for his Princeton team to win a game.
DiGiacomo kicks it away. Flynn back at his 44, and one of the few times calls for a fair catch. So with 17 seconds left to go here at Palmer Stadium, Pennsylvania enjoys a 23-10 lead over the Princeton Tigers. Princeton will suffer their 3rd loss in the league. Yale as well suffers their 3rd. Harvard as well, if that score holds, their 3rd. So that really knocks 3 teams out of the potential championship. Quarterback for Pennsylvania, number 16, Scott Morcott, who we saw at the end of last week, as the clock runs down.